Hey, you guys.
Oh, let's do lunch and have story time. I doubt very seriously I'll eat this whole bowl of cup of noodles. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Of all the Christmases that I can remember, like some of the gifts that I got, I was thinking of that this morning. There's a whole bowl. What in the world? I guess I'm too anxious to get this party started, but you can see real life, Angela behind the scenes, in front of the scenes. I think what got my, I think what got me thinking about this is, again, first thing in the morning, they show all the fires, all the houses burning, and what they deem to be soon history. And the sad part is it really hits close to home in Ventura County, and then burning up through Santa Barbara County, and all these places that pop up on the news that are burning down, I know and recognize, because I used to live in Santa Barbara. But so anyways, you know, they talked about the houses that burned, and they would show Christmas trees and all the presents that burned. Sad. It got me thinking of my Christmases, and the very, very, very first Christmas I can remember is age 3. I'm serious. reason to think what would happen if I actually, it'd be such a great 8 mile. I always think of Kramer on Seinfeld. But anyways, then this had to be 1962. And I remember my mom. I think she was so happy because my dad had bought it. At the time, he was a pilot. Or back in the early day, I guess you call him like a navigator. He wasn't the pilot. Wasn't the co-pilot. He was like the third chair behind, which back then they used to call the navigator, I think. And my dad was not a shopper, and he was not big on buying tons of stuff for his kids. He was just like your old-fashioned, traditional man of the house. Now, shopping was the woman's thing, and working and bringing home the bacon was the man's thing. So I do remember opening that gift, and my mom being just as happy and excited about the gift as I was. And she was like making sure I didn't tear it apart and ruin it. And so you can imagine how happy and excited I was. But then my mom was like so fragile about it and cautious because my dad hadn't woken up yet. And I think she wanted to save it. And then let my dad see me with it. But I think she was just as happy because dad did really good. He would get all the American stuff in Japan. He used to fly to Japan all the time. And the stuff there would be super, super, super cheap. So, anyways. I must admit, that was like the first Christmas I do remember, as if it was yesterday. And, let's see where else. Oh, another Christmas that I do remember that I thought I was going to just cry my heart out because I wasn't going to get a gift. My mother had got for my cousin, which was a swinger camera. You guys remember that? In the 60s, it was a Polaroid, black and white Polaroid camera. It was called the swinger. Well, my mom, I think I always was feeling sorry for myself because my mom was godmother to my favorite cousin, and every holiday, Christmas and birthday time, my mom and my cousin, godmother and goddaughter, would always exchange lovely gifts, and my godmother and godfather were the complete opposite. They did not do that for me. So we'd always gather around with the relatives at Christmas time, and my cousin getting lovely gifts from her godmother, and I get nothing. But as a kid, that's a little bit stressful. It was very, very stressful. So one day I happened to be snooping in my mom's closet, and I see a Polaroid, the swinger camera. I'm thinking it's for me. And bigger than being, she brings it out one day. And of all things, she wants me to wrap it. And I'm just torn apart, thinking, like, Mom, I can't believe you're getting her this. I want this. So I don't know what happened. I don't remember seeing two swinger cameras there hiding to be wrapped. I just remember seeing one. So So I wonder if my mom kind of felt my heart and went out and got another camera for me, because there on Christmas Day was a swinger camera. That was a good one. I believe it was like grammar school. I can't remember when they came out. I don't believe I was in junior high. Maybe junior high, but for some reason it seems like sixth grade when back then that was still grammar school. It used to be divided. 7th, 8th, and 9th grade was junior high, and 10th, 11th, and 12th grade was high school. But I think that has changed now. That was a very cool Christmas. Then, I will never forget the Christmas we woke up and there was a swing set in our garage, all assembled and put together. There was like a big banner. You know how you wake up on Christmas morning and then there's the goodies that Santa brings? And they're like unwrapped. It's stuff that's just sitting there unwrapped. So I don't know how we knew that our swing set was out in the garage. But I remember going out there and there was a brand new swing set. And that was a fun Christmas. I had a brother and a sister. Just entering high school, our baby sister. But this was like in the 60s, I think. No, that was a totally fun Christmas. And I remember it being so cold. And we go in the garage and it's cement flooring. All three of us room. And you can hear the metal swing set like rocking. And even as a kid in junior, I remember thinking, oh my gosh, we're going to tip. And we're going to crack our head. Crazy. I'm amazed at myself how I remember these little things so well, as if it was yesterday. But okay, so that was that. Then, this other Christmas when we woke up and there were three brand new bicycles, big wheel bicycles, one for each of us, all staged right in front of the Christmas tree. This was before they had those little, I guess they're called stingray bicycles with a small tire, like a banana boat seat. Like that wasn't even a thing. We were so excited. And I think there's pictures somewhere of me in my robe riding my bike outside Christmas morning. And then later on in the day, you know, as the neighbors and our friends came out with their Christmas toys, I'll never forget, like, the big disappointment. Because I think I was still, it was still such a young age that you kind of believe in Santa, but then you kind of don't. But when you wake up on Christmas morning and you see those shiny, fun toys, and then you look to see that Santa came and he ate his milk and cookies, there's that little part of you that's like, oh my goodness, this is really Santa Claus. And the disappointment came when we were outside and our neighbors, our friends from across the street, they had like four kids and we were friends with all of them. The one boy runs out and said that he already knew it. He saw my dad when he was, last night when we were asleep, he said, we were up till midnight. They go to midnight mass. it's just a huge Catholic thing. I remember that. I'll tell you that story in a minute. But so we're riding our bike, and he comes out all excited. We're telling him what we got. And he says, yeah, we saw your dad as he was reeling the wheeling the bikes into the house last night because we were coming home from midnight mass. Or that was such a disappointment. I said, what? Excuse me. And I always remember that. And remember that, you know, there's emotions and memories you have only as a kid that you really can't. I couldn't tell my friends that I kind of still believed in Santa Claus because that wouldn't have went over well. But I do remember, like, kind of being, like, disappointed, very disappointed. So, let's see, what else? Oh, growing up Catholic and having to go to church on Christmas morning. Oh my goodness. That was probably the most painful event every Christmas morning. I will never forget. As young kids, we always, growing up Catholic, we always had to go to church on Christmas morning. Then, rumor has it that once I grew up, I left home. Then my parents started going to midnight mass. And I don't know how they swung that because my brothers and sisters were still living at home. Unless most, only the Christmases that they didn't travel to visit relatives on Christmas Eve. But I remember them going to church on Christmas Eve so they wouldn't have to go on Christmas Day. And I thought, well, that's a way to do it. Like all those years I suffered as a kid. And what the tradition would be, we'd get up on Christmas morning and we'd be able to play with the little toys that Santa had left. And the stuff in our stocking. But then, to have to not touch anything else, we had to go to a Catholic church service, Sunday Mass. And, oh, that was the hardest thing as a kid. And then, there was another part of Christmas, and I don't remember. This happened. I think it happened like a few weeks before Christmas when we had our tree up. We would take family photos. Oh my goodness. I don't know what my mother was thinking. Was she trying to get like a good family photo just for us, or was she trying to get a good Christmas family photo to send and get, you know, send out in the Christmas card? I'm not sure. Every time I see Christmas pictures of us, you know, when we were little back in the 60s, I kind of remember. I could tell just by the look on my face how stressful. And or maybe she just wanted a nice Christmas family photo for her family. I don't know. But that was always thrown in there. And so there was that. Those are the Christmases that kind of stand out that I really remember. I'm trying to think if there's another one I remember that I kind of forgot about. Many, many Christmases I would get clothing for my Barbie and Ken doll. Like my dad, it was a tradition after that first Christmas where he got me the Barbie and Ken doll that he would get. know what to call it. It would be from Japan on a huge cardboard. They were like, you just wouldn't get like a dress or an outfit. You got like a whole storyline. I'll never forget. For Barbie, I got like a little Red Riding Hood ensemble for Barbie. It was like an outfit. Story. It was like a whole thing on a cardboard that was sewed into the cardboard. It came from Japan. And again, my mom just was really excited because for my dad to do that kind of shopping was amazing. And so that was interesting. You never just got like one little outfit. It was a ton of stuff on a big board. And you'd get like two or three different pairs of shoes, two or three different purses, and hats, and clothing, and I can't remember if it was specifically just for Barbie, or it was Barbie and Ken together, but they were very, very unique, and I never saw anything like that in, like when we would go to the store, and I'd look at Barbie stuff. Here in America, it was just like one or two little. You'd have to go and get that exact outfit and accessories along with that outfit. Anyway, I remember a lot of Christmases like that. And then, probably my worst Christmas was the first year, 1979. I moved to Santa Barbara, left home. That was January of 1979. So December of that year came around, and I'm just expecting like the same kind of family Christmas that we've always had, right? So my parents know I'm coming, and I'm thinking, oh, yay. Oh, I get there. And they kind of already had Christmas. They opened their gifts because my brother and sister, and then at this time in 79, my little sister was like six or seven. They had already had their Christmas. I was like shocked. And it totally made sense. You know, I, for almost a year, I've been living out on my own, but I think there was still that huge expectation. You know, even at age 20, even though I was out on my own, when they said, yeah, come on, we're going to have Christmas at our house. We'll open presents. When I'm thinking, it's like, okay, we're going to open presents. And that's kind of what I think of when angry grandpa has his terrible Christmas moments of when the family opens presents without him. I know the feeling. It's just a terrible feeling. And so not only that, but then when I got there, my parents weren't even home waiting for me. My parents, they were like totally doing their own thing. They had gone to church, and now they were like visiting friends. I don't know. But when I got there, it was as if I didn't even exist. That was terrible. I wasn't expecting it. But anyways, they didn't. Of course, they didn't do it intentionally. Let's see. So then, then I guess there was December of 1981. This wasn't a gift on Christmas morning, but it was a gift like the week or so before Christmas. I always remember it because that's when my husband asked me out on our first date. We kind of reconnected. And he was always like our neighbor. his kids. He and his wife had divorced, but they had remained friends. And so when his wife came back into town, she would let us know. And she said, hey, come on over. I got the kids. And it was always fun for my little sister to get together with them because they're the same age. So, and we get there, and there's my husband-to-be. But at the time, obviously, I didn't know it. But he hadn't seen me for a while. And I had grown up and moved away and became a beautiful young lady. And bigger than beans by the end of that night, that visit. He was so, so happy, like, to rekindle our friendship. Asked me out on our first date, which was going to be February, like Valentine's weekend, like the 13th, 14th, and 15th, I believe, in 1982, was a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And of all things, he invited me to a military ball. And I was so excited. I don't remember anything about Christmas that year, because for me, was my Christmas, that my fun best friend was gonna take me to a military ball, and my mind, it was just like over the top excited and happy, because I always love to get dressed up. I always love stuff like that. And I remember kept asking him, I said, are you serious? Are you really gonna take me? He says, yes, because it was such a wonderful invite. With such a wonderful, fun friend. I was best Christmas gift ever, even though it really wasn't like a Christmas gift. When I remember Christmas of 1981, that's what stands out. And so that kind of lasted like for till the ball came, the Valentine's weekend in February of 82. For those whole 2 months, I was like still having Christmas, buying my dress, buying my all my accessories, thinking of how I'm going to do my hair and everything. And it was down in San Diego, so it was going to be a fun road trip from Santa Barbara. Then we, at the time he lived in Simi Valley, so I drove from Santa Barbara down to Simi Valley, to Simi Valley to San Diego. It was a wonderful time at the Sheraton. Remember the Sheraton Hotel? We haven't been in ages. And was there a Harbor Island or a Balboa Island in San Diego? I want to say Harbor Island. I know Balboa Island. That's over in Irvine. Is it like Newport Beach? Because my daughter lived on Balboa Island during our college years. So I believe at the time the Sheraton was on Harbor Island, San Diego. I have to do my research. So that was awesome. Then, the following Christmas, 1982, I was kind of dumbfounded. My husband, we got married. Our first date was February of 82. We got engaged in March of 82. Got married in July of 82. And had our first Christmas together in December of 82. And my husband got me a brand new 10-speed bike. I was dumbfounded. Like, I didn't ask for a bike. What possessed you to get me this 10-speed bike? And so I'm sure I hurt his feelings. But he had a plan in mind. He knew we were very active, and he felt that if we had new 10-speed bikes, we could have fun bike riding. And yes, he was right, but I was just dumbfounded. And he said, well, that's, and it was like, he got it from Sears at the time. He had worked at Sears and he found it on sale and it was a super deal. And it was such a good deal that he bought two of them. One for me that he gave me at Christmas, and he had his on layaway for his birthday. And when he was telling me this, I remember being more mad than happy, because I felt that he was just thinking of him. That's something that he wanted to do, and that he even got a bike for himself. But then after I got over all my angry, selfish thoughts, you know, I understood. And then, you know, the next day came and New Year's had come, and of course we always have wonderful weather here in Southern California. And so, of course, I was happy, and I was so happy. I said, you need to go get your death speed, even though his birthday wasn't for a couple more months. I said, you need to go and get your And so it turned out to be a fun Christmas, but I'll never forget waking up to find that 10-speed bike and being like confused, thinking, what? Like, that was like the farthest thing from my mind. Excuse me. But it did make sense, and it did turn out to be a wonderful gift. I'm stuffed. So, refrigerate this a while, because I still have more Christmases to talk about. I'm not sure if I should do a part two and continue. So it will be, I'll continue from Christmas stories from 1982 to present. I'm not sure if I have that great of a memory about the Christmases from 1982 till the present, because then by 1982 we had our first. I mean, it'll be Christmas. This last Christmas when my husband got me the 10-speed, that was Christmas of 82. So I'll start off with Christmas of 83. We had our first child for that Christmas of 83. It's interesting when I look back, is once we had our kid, I can't remember like my birthdays. I can't remember like from age to age very well about me, nor can I remember every single Christmas as well about me as I did prior to being married and having kids. But I'll share with you a handful of really good Christmases that I remember. Some good gifts for me, and also gifts that we got our kids. And you know, you really think you know somebody. I was native California, and my husband was native Hoosier, Indiana. And I was so naive. I just kind of thought, you know, Americans are Americans, and we're all the same. But the truth is, people from different states and even different counties in the same state, there's so many different things. And one big conflict I realized after, I think our kids were about to enter junior high, I realized that when they grew up for Christmas, a ton of stuff for Christmas. They got one or two very big items, pricey big items, exceptional items. We were different. We would get a big item when we woke up and we saw Santa Claus. It left us a fun big thing. But then we got a ton of other things. And there was this subliminal Christmas because I'd want to do all these things. And I could tell my husband would be so upset because he was saving his money all through the year for big items. And I didn't save my money. I just, you know, whatever money we had was buying up all these fun little things that I knew they were like. So I knew that they would like. So it was two different expectations of Christmas that we had for our children. And it was never really spoken about, but once they got, you know, junior in high school, I kind of figured it out, like, oh my gosh, I'm not going to go through another Christmas of stress and my husband just be upset. And he would really be upset because he didn't understand it, and I didn't understand him. Like, what are you talking about? That's like the fun part of Christmas, all these presents. Because that's how I grew up. But for him, that wasn't the fun part. The fun part was you knew when Christmas came, you were getting the gift of the year. And I did see how he did that with our kids. Like, when the iPods, do you remember when the very, very first iPod came out? He got our kids, like, each, I think they were like $300, and I was just, excuse me, I was kind of shocked, like, are you serious? But it all worked out, you know. And two, I'm realizing how foolish it is to argue and fight and spend so much time being angry and mad. It's really it's such a waste of energy and time. My husband was happy to give it to them. They were happy to get it. And what happened, he got one iPod for two girls. They're like, this kind of the same age. And he thought, he says, they can share, they can get headphones with two jacks. And I remember thinking, well, for $300, that was a good idea. But it turned out they really each needed their own. So the following week, my husband had gotten one for my other daughter because her birthday was coming up. So it was like an early birthday gift. And they ended up each with their own iPod right out of the gate. I do believe that was like the big first Apple item they got. Can't remember the year. Sometime in the 90s, I think. I have to see when the Apple iPod first came out. And that was the first, that Christmas of 83. Excuse me, that wasn't Christmas of 83. That was when our, whatever Christmas that was, when the iPod came out, that was also my introduction to the Apple Store. I didn't know, you know, my husband is such the nanotech, and he's just such an intellectual geek. He's like the first person I ever knew who is like a geek, a science geek, a math geek, a computer whiz, a real intellectual. He's the first intellectual person I've ever known who was not a geek. You could spot a geek like a mile away. They had the look. Everything about them said geek. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but they were just their own little group of people. My husband was the first person I knew who was like your good neighbor, the best neighbor you could ask for, your all-American guy. And in parentheses, you'd have to put geek because he's just so intelligent. But anyway, I didn't know about Apple, and he was all into Apple, and it was all Greek. It was all geek to me. And that year, whatever year, I'll never forget. And going to the shopping malls, this was one fun thing about in the air and fun and music and family. And he used to love to do that, not to go shopping, but he would want to go and be in the Christmas crowds and see what was there. And so when that iPod came out, that was like my first introduction to these Apple stores. He would beeline. We'd go to the malls with the Apple stores. He'd make a beeline, and I would be so confused because back in the day, the stores were very small, and there was only like a couple tables of items, and you would see these people kind of hovering around these little white tables at these gadgets, and I'm like, "What? Let's get out of here!" As I'm somewhat claustrophobic, and he was as happy as could be. Anyways, that's a Christmas memory too, I guess. Real vivid in my mind, though it wasn't an actual Christmas on Christmas morning. It was the year of the on the iPod came out, which was just music, I believe. I believe that device wasn't a phone, wasn't a computer or anything else. It was just music, I think. So whatever Christmas that was, whatever year that came out, in the 90s sometime, that was a fun Christmas. I have no clue about what was going on with me that Christmas, but as far as the kids and my husband, oh my goodness, and it was my kind of little introduction to Apple, and it would just grow bigger and better in our lives all the years to come. I'm gonna have to wrap up here pretty soon. So, one tradition we kind of had, and I don't know how we did it. We started it when our kids. No, we may have started it. We may have started it the first year. Husband had little kids also that would come, that would visit every so often. I think we started like the first year we were married. Thanksgiving Day was a stay-at-home celebration day. We didn't go running around from relatives to relatives celebrating Thanksgiving. We pretty much stayed at home, and we decorated. We got our tree and everything up, so that Christmas for us started Thanksgiving Day. It was as if you had a longer Christmas holiday, if that makes sense. And that tradition, just, I guess it was a tradition we just started, because I don't remember growing up doing that. I don't remember that my husband said, yeah, that's what we did. I don't remember that. I think it's just something we do. So our kids would have a longer time for more fun for Christmas. Well, that always started on Thanksgiving Day. And let's see what else. Oh, the other memory I kind of remember. I remember my parents being so stressed. This is growing up in the 60s and early 70s. Both of my grandparents and both sets of relatives and cousins all lived in LA area. which is understandable. Her family celebrated Christmas Eve, and my dad's family celebrated Christmas Day. So my mom had all this stuff to juggle. She wanted to see her family Christmas Eve. She wanted to see my dad's family Christmas Day. She wanted to make sure we were the good Catholic family and we got to church on Christmas morning. But she also wanted to have Christmas with her family. So that was a little bit of subliminal stress going on, I do remember. But we did it so many years, and I do have fun memories of being at both grandparents' house for Christmas. Fun memories. I just remember subliminally the stress my mom would go through having to do so many things so that we would all get it in. But we did get it in, and I'm grateful for my parents. That wasn't easy. And then we had my dad, who was a pilot, and sometimes he would get in like a day or two before Christmas from his flights. And even though he'd have a week or 10 days off, it takes a few days to get back to where you're in your normal sleeping pattern. So I'm so grateful for my parents that we did do that, because it has given me great Christmas memories ever at both grandparents. And even though I'm sure my dad was so tired, because he used to say that when he would get home, and my mom, she'd have all these like little things planned, and I can remember so many times my dad would get out his little checklist of things to do.
My mom
would say, "Why are you writing it down? Why are you writing it down on your to-do list? What are you doing right now? Why can't you do it right now?" And he would shake his head. He says, "Remember, I need a few days to catch up on my sleep." And most of his trips were to Japan back then. So that's a real big time change from here to Japan. And then the jet lag and, you know, just all this stuff. And that was kind of funny. She, after all the years, she still couldn't figure out.
Well, you're up right now. What are you doing now?
That's funny, but it's good. Good memories. Again, I'm grateful. I do remember, though, my dad used to really be upset if he caught us watching TV too much. There's like a couple things my dad had really good wisdom about back in the 60s that I think my mom thought he was crazy. But when I look back at it today, that my dad had some really good wisdom that I kind of still admire today. And his first big beef was cereal. He would scream at my mom, say, "Why are you giving these kids cereal? The sugar, sugar, sugar is the first. Look at all their sugar." And my mom just would pitch a fit. And I think it got to be when he was away on a trip, we'd get cereal. But on the days when he was home to keep my dad, we'd get like cream of wheat or oatmeal and toast and eggs. I do remember we'd get the combination, and I think that's how my mom worked it out. She would do that when my dad was home to keep the peace. But wasn't that wise of him back in the 60s? Because we're finding that sugar today is not the best thing for our brain and our body. But that was wonderful. And I never really remember her hopping on board and saying, "You might have a point." But, you know, she did keep the peace. And she did it his way when he was home. But then she just would do it her way, I guess, when he was gone. But I think that was really wise back in the 60s to not want to have your kids have a bowl of sugar, cereal filled with sugar, first thing in the morning. other thing. He was, oh, TV. He used to get my mom so flustered. He'd say, how long have those kids been watching TV? He didn't like it for two reasons. Couch potato wasn't a term back then, but he didn't like the fact that we were sitting around watching TV. He couldn't fathom that, because when he was a kid, he was active, outside. But that did kind of bother him. But the other thing was the commercials would put ideas in our head. And we'd say, oh, Mom, I want this. I want this for Christmas. I want this for Christmas. And he didn't like that whole attitude of the advertisers throwing these things in front of our face in commercial and then getting the kids all excited and then getting the kids to say, I want. That was very wise, too, because being a couch potato isn't healthy at all. We need to be moving. And there is something destructive, I think, for when we're watching a show and all of a sudden we're bombarded with ads. It really is, honestly, it's a downer for me as an older person. A lot of the times when I'm watching a show and there's an ad, I just flip the channel immediately to one of the shopping networks or a faith-based channel where I know they have no commercials. That's like my quick escape. And what happened to my little, gosh, you guys, I was right. Oh, so waking up is getting really loud, so it is definitely time to say goodbye for this portion of our video. So anyways, this has been fun, and a reminder, enjoyed this video in any way, found it relaxing, informative, or entertaining, feel free to give it a thumbs up, push the like button, and please share it with somebody. I really appreciate it. And I'll have to do a part two of, I don't know what I'll call this, of course it'll be a rambling. Let's do lunch, or eating, rambling. It's been fun. Thank goodness I remembered to take my enzymes, or I'd be so sluggish right now. Maybe 2 days.